BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest, and we're coming up on the holiday season, and there are many ways that people are celebrating it throughout this month of December and into January. And also, I hope you have a wonderful time. I hope you get a chance to be with family and friends and enjoy their company as well. And if you're thinking about maybe a last-minute gift for Hanukkah, Christmas, Kwanzaa, whatever, I hope you consider a pair of tickets to any of the local theater groups in the area. We have wonderful opportunities to see very good theater. For example, Genesius just finished Cinderella. Reading Theater Project did Present, Past, and Future, and those are just a couple of things that were going on. Also, Reading Civic Theater and Fleetwood Community Theater up there at Albright. There's so much going on, so I hope you think about maybe using that as a stocking stuffer, or. Even if you want, you could even make a gift to one of the community theaters in the way of a donation. That may brighten their spirits as well as yours. And here at BCTV, that would be very fine as well. We would certainly appreciate it because we depend on you folks out there. So tonight, I'm going to get into a little bit of some of the backstage elements. And in theater, there are so many jobs to be done, so many designers, so many technicians, so many actors, stage crew, front of house people. There's a lot going on. But one of the few people that have an overall control are the directors. And with me tonight, I have one of our local directors, and we'll find out a little bit about directing, what it entails, and also a little bit about his experiences and the way he chooses to direct a show. With me tonight is Jody Reppert. Welcome to Backstage.
Thank you.
It's good to have you back again. And you are first of all, let's find out a little bit about your background. What's your theater training?
Well, I went to Millersville, and also I did some work at Arizona State University. Mm-hmm. But most of my training is just by doing. So I've been involved in high school theater for a long time, for more than 30 years, and have also done local and community theaters. Mm-hmm. Have acted and directed and been part of the tech teams. Mm-hmm. So I've done a little bit of everything for a pretty long time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, you mentioned all those different aspects of it. Has being able to work in all those different aspects helped you with your directing and directing styles and the productions?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. Well, one thing as a high school director, you wear so many different hats. So like you're involved in all of the tech aspects of the show, sets, costumes, lighting, sound, props, building the set. You're involved with tickets in front of house and seating, and so you do a little bit of everything. Mm-hmm. I have experience doing lots of those jobs, so I enjoy that.
Good. I guess that helps with when you're doing an actual production, you're on the boards for that night as opposed to rehearsal. I guess that helps you understand what's going on out there and there in the rest of the theater, and knowing what their challenges may be.
Yeah, I mean, as a director, I feel like I have a grasp on lighting and sound and mm-hmm. staging. So having a background in all of those things as well as acting really helps me to be a better director. Like one of the things that I love about theater, one of the things that I love about directing, like you had mentioned all of the different jobs, I love the collaborative aspect. So I love collaborating with the different production teams, and then also with the actors. It really is a collaborative process that it's not me having, as a director, a blueprint of the way that everything is going to be right from the start. It's really a matter of collaborating with the different teams to figure out, to draw out the best from their talents so that we can bring that to the production. So having a background in those different areas really helps me when talking with the set designer, since I've designed and built sets, or working with lighting, knowing what the possibilities are. So, like I said, as a high school director, you have to do a little bit of all of that, and that has really helped me in all of my different directing gigs mm-hmm. that I've done. That background's been I think, really a benefit. So it's been terrific.
Yeah, especially pre-show, you're just about ready to go on boards for the day's performance, and then something goes not quite the way you wanted it to, and then you have to understand how things go with taking care of whatever comes up.
Yeah, I mean, troubleshooting, so it's like mm-hmm. trying to figure out ways around it. I mean, I think theater directing, it's a big bag of tricks, so it's like figuring out, like having, with more experience, you have more tricks to draw from. So when mm-hmm. things do go not as expected, you're able to like figure out ways around those. And, and it's having also not panicking, it's about trying to maintain a calm when things aren't going quite as planned, and trying to like figure out how you can best use your resources and mm-hmm. and the people that are there to figure out how to help them do their jobs better.
Mm-hmm. Do you recall any last minute crisis or situations that you've had that maybe one that might have stood out in particular, that you had to rely on this general knowledge on how to get the people together to take care of it, and also how much time it might take?
I'm thinking there was a production when I was just out of college that my wife actually had directed. So mm-hmm. she was directing at Wilson, mm-hmm. and there was she got a phone call. She was directing, she was doing student teaching at Wilson, mm-hmm. and she had directed a 30-minute production. So it was a one-act mm-hmm. play. And she got a call a half hour before the show that one of the actors was actually in the hospital and couldn't. So we have an audience coming in, and so she asked me to go on with script in hand. You know, so I went on with script in hand just to get through it. But you know, so you've got to do what you have to do to try to make it work.
Yeah, I know. I've seen a few myself that were.
Yeah, yeah.
They were very interesting. Now, what are some of your theater credits that you have, you know, down in Arizona or in the area or, you know, Noblesville, where have you? What are some of the shows you've done?
Some of the shows? I've done lots of musicals. One of the things that... I'm really proud of. So we got involved with the Pennsylvania Thespians when I was directing high school things, and we took shows to the Pennsylvania Thespian Festival. So it's one of the neatest audiences that we'll have. There's like literally 1,200 drama kids there, and to present in front those guys, you'll never have a more appreciative, open audience. And we did some main stage productions there that were really well received, and that was neat. We did Laramie Project, which was outstanding, and we also did Godspell at the festival, and we also did productions from Edgar Allan Poe, scenes from Edgar Allan Poe. So, but those audiences, just like it was so neat to see the response that our kids got, and how positive the whole experience was. That was really neat. I've also directed a couple of times down at EPAC, so I had a chance to do The Crucible there. Also, Man of No Importance. So I directed. There was a show, Story Theater. So we did that there as well. And that space and working with that those artists there was really fulfilling. That was terrific. So, So I've done tons of productions.
And that when you work with so many different groups, it really gives you a chance to see how other people do this. There's some general things that you do, you know, procedures and all that, but how you rewrite the script on that, so to speak, how that works. Have you found any really radical changes in way people do things, or maybe what they concentrate on a little bit more than...
Yeah, well, I mean, I think every actor, every director, every acting coach, so everybody has their own style. There are lots of different approaches that you can take to acting and to putting a show on. I think you can break those down into basically two categories. So those would be like ones that work from the inside out, and then you can also have systems that work from the outside in. So the inside out is that you're working with the actor to try to get them to feel a certain way, and that when they feel a certain way, then the outside will take care of itself. And then you have the other system then that will work from the outside in, you know, where you're not really worried about what's going on the inside. It's, does it look right? You know, so you're working from the outside in. And I would say, you know, broadly speaking, like old traditional musicals are, they're not so much worried about like what your motivation is on the outside. It's are you doing the steps right, you know, and are does it look right from the outside? So those two different camps, everybody will fall someplace in the spectrum of like working more method, like from the inside out versus the outside in. You know, and my first experience was doing musicals when, you know, we did like some character work, but it wasn't until until I did things at at school at Millersville, and also like getting a chance to do some things down at EPAC, like really opened my eyes to the like what the possibilities are, like working from like the character motives, thinking about like what the character's objective, tactic, and obstacle is, and thinking about like internal things that really transformed the way that I started thinking about what the possibilities are in theater. You know, and working with high school kids, it's neat to work with them when they're just starting to discover some of those things, and they have like enthusiasm. That enthusiasm is really contagious. So, I think the idea of probably, I would say like at EPAC, the thing that's been most transformational, like probably going back to your question, like what, we're probably working with Ed Fernandez, like he's, is just has a strong vision and a drive and a not, a willingness to accept stuff that doesn't feel authentic and that isn't real. You know, and I think like that really has influenced me and my approach. You know, whereas in the past I was hesitant, especially with like younger actors, to push you know, for that, like it would be, oh, that's okay, like just accepting it. And instead realizing that again, there's another level that you can get to, if you're able to find the right buttons to push and go from there. So I don't know if that answered your question, but
yes, it does, and it brings something else to it. That doing a production, whether it's your first time or your 101st time, it's a growth process, and all where you learn a little bit more and you add different things to it as you go along.
Yeah, and I, you know, and it's working with, it's not me as the director telling the actor this is the way that you should do it. You know, it's not say it like this or move like this, but it's trying to help the actor find connections within themselves so that they can be truthful, you know, and make choices and work on stage to create things that are interesting, because that's really what it's about. You know, it's creating something that's truthful and interesting and that can connect with the audience and with the piece and with everything, so.
Yes, and I've seen recently a few shows that have done, approached it in a lot of the styles you've just been talking about, going from an exterior where, okay, I want you to move here to maybe a point where I want you to say it this way, think this, or whatever, to the way that where you have a goal, but it's not cast in stone.
Yeah.
That as you go through it, the actors and all contribute to things, and sometimes external circumstances such as lighting, venue abilities, and all that.
Yeah, and I was thinking about, there was a production of Lost in Yonkers that I had directed, and this was with a high school group, and they were with high school students who had some experience, and they were like really terrific, and there was an actor who was playing the grandmother, and again, it's a 17-year-old playing, you know, 75-year-old, you know, so like there's a large leap that she has to make to be able to figure out like where she can identify with the grandmother, you know, like with somebody who's like 75 years old, you know, so helping that 17-year-old make those connections, you know, and the grandmother like had a limp, so she had something wrong with her leg, you know, and one of the things, like as a director, rather than saying, oh, I want you to limp like this, one of the things that I do is ask about that pain, so that pain then can become, okay, so tell me, so your leg hurts, what does that feel like, where did it come from, how does it, you know, so asking questions as a director rather than, I think, helps the actor to make connections and then create something that's more connected and real. So having the actor answer those questions or go through that thought process is more beneficial than for me saying, I want you to limp like this, you know, having her to think about what that pain was doing for that character, I think was more meaningful than anything else I could have said, so.
Yeah, it's getting down to the intrinsics of the character, the essence of it, and why, you know, what, as you said, with the limp, why are you limping, and where is the pain, and all, or why the character feels the way he or she does, or act the way he or she does.
You know, and connecting it then to a time where that 17-year-old had a pain. Like, is there something that you felt that was similar to it so that you can draw that common experience that your character had and then draw that into it?
Yeah.
You know, and then that also then goes with, you know, the emotional landscape, you know, as the experiences that a 17-year-old's gonna have to a 75-year-old, like, wouldn't have, for example, maybe the same sense of loss that, the 75-year-old did, but everyone has experienced some loss, so, like, drawing some connections from whatever that was, so that what they can be working with is something truthful, you know, and that ultimately is also something that we're looking for, is truthful. And as a director, when I'm watching performances or things on stage, that's one of the things that goes through my mind, or that, that I'm looking for specifically, or are things that don't ring true. Like, if something feels false, like it feels like you were told to move at a certain place, or it feels like the character's not connected, you know, then that's a point then that we have to work on and find the right buttons to push or the right questions to ask so that the character can feel connected.
And it's discovering what is in your toolbox as well as the actor's toolbox, because, you know, the age and experience for as well as the different styles of acting and working on a production does that. You brought to mind sense memory with that, with the pain and all. And sometimes it's as simple as maybe, okay, you had a pain in your leg and blah, 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 and this is how you reacted. Now the pain is up here. How do you think you might react? Also, using experiences or like the sense of smell, the sense of touch, taste, whatever, to help develop your character.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're looking to engage the senses, like, and those things make the performances more textured and more interesting, because again, ultimately we're going for something that's connected, that's authentic and real, and stuff that's interesting to look at. You know, and things that are interesting to look at are things that are real. Like, one of the things that I say, like, if you have, so if you may have two great actors on stage, you know, and if there's a cat on stage between the two actors, even if they're doing great things, I guarantee half the audience is watching the cat. You know, then you ask yourself, okay, why is that? Why is the audience watching, like, when two actors may be raising, like, great dialogue, or, but what is it about the cat that's interesting? Well, one thing that's interesting is that anything could happen. Like, the cat could, like, just run off stage or do something that they hadn't planned, and that's interesting. You know, so as a director thinking about that, like, making it feel like anything could happen, I think is important. Like, I think, like, that's a tool that you have in your toolbox to try to make it work. And also, you know that what the cat is experiencing at the moment is real. Like, if the cat is acting afraid, like if the cat like rears back and acts afraid, or if the cat's very comfortable, like that is an authentic feeling, and there's something that's interesting about watching something that's authentic, you know. So I think like, again, thinking about like why would the audience be drawn to that, and I think like those two things can help you as a director and as an actor inform your approach, like, and inform tools that you're going to use.
And be aware of anything might happen during performance when you cannot say stop or whatever.
Right.
I mean, even here at BCTV with live TV, we've had some interesting experiences where, you know, you have an animal on. One of our technicians years ago put together a video about what to do and what not to do. And they opened the barn doors, and they had the horse set in there that it's supposed to be looking out. The horse changed its mind.
Oh,
turned
great.
Around.
That's great.
And lifted the tail.
Oh, no.
Yep.
Oh, that's classic.
Yeah, and you can't do anything about it. You know, if you have the luxury of editing it, but, there were cooking shows here, so at one time and during the day, and you had to follow them quickly, and if the egg, fell on the floor or whatever like that, you got to go with it and follow what's going on.
There was an interesting story. So there was a friend of ours. So he was in a play, and there was a. So there was a scene that there were two guys on stage. There was a phone in the scene. Now, the phone's not supposed to ring until the second act. This is in the first act. Mm-hmm. But this was a phone that had a ringer attached to it. So it actually, like, the phone actually rang. It wasn't a sound effect that came over the speaker, so it was ringing. So in the first act, the phone started to ring, and it didn't stop. It, like, kept going. So the one actor picks up the phone. Now, the logical thing to do, or, like, the nice thing to do would be to say, oh, sorry, wrong number, or I can't talk now, I'll get back to you. And, like, no, here, it's for you. Gives it to the other guy. So then the other guy's has to come up with a way to get out of it. So that was that wasn't a very nice approach. Because then the other guy couldn't say, sorry, wrong number or anything like that. He had to come up with a whole spiel how to get out of it. So that was interesting. So
yeah. Yeah, that is one of the enjoyable things and frustrating things of doing a live production, whether it be on camera. Back in the pioneer days with Soupy Sales and all that, you never could tell what would happen there. And there's some fantastic stories from there.
Yeah,
as well as on stage and all. And
do you know what too? And like with. Again, working with high school kids, I've talked to like some directors who get uptight about actors like flubbing lines or whatever. I always felt like the kids, we do a lot with, or we had been doing a lot with improv. Mm-hmm. So our kids were pretty adept at improv. And also, like, I felt like our process was strong, that the that the actors knew what the objective were in the scene and what they were doing and what had to happen, that I felt confident that, no matter what happens, they would be able to stay in the moment and be able to get through it. And I think that is a part of that is like with an improv background, that they didn't get uptight if things weren't exactly right, or if like they really couldn't be thrown because again they felt secure in the arc of the scene and what had to happen. So it's just an interesting thing.
Yeah. Now you recently directed a production with Reading Theatre Project with Grave Concern, and that was a fascinating experience for me to be behind the scenes watching you direct, as well as a couple other directors that were involved with the three one-act plays there. Now, tell us a little bit about that, if you would, please, from the beginning when you got the script and what you thought about it, where you thought the playwright might be going, and then how you worked with the actors to create the production that you did.
Yeah, so when I read the script, I connected with it. I really liked the themes in mm-hmm. the story, and the characters were interesting. The just a quick overview, the play is actually set in Charles Evans Cemetery, which was an interesting thing, mm-hmm. and there's a woman, her character's name is Eve, who comes to the cemetery, and she's a photographer, and she was sent to the cemetery to take pictures, to do like a photographic essay, so she's for a magazine. So, and she's a type of woman that she's professional, and she's really driven, and she mm-hmm. works a ton of hours, and she has a mother at home who's sick, and she's getting calls from her family updating her with her mother, and she's saying, well, I can't come now, but I can come later. So she's clearly putting off her home life for her family, mm-hmm. I mean, for her family life for her work. And there are then characters that are ghosts from the graveyard that appear. And each has their own story. So there's a woman who died in the fire in the 1930s, who is basically kind of like her guardian angel. So she's like mm-hmm. she's been following her around, and she's not the ghost isn't sure why she's been following her around, but she knows that she can't leave Eve until something happens. So she's in a place. Then there's another ghost who's kind of like the caretaker of the cemetery, and he's there. And then there's a young bride who died early 1900s, and she's there. And then there's someone who died, a young man who died more recently, and he's there. So there's these collection of four or five ghosts that are there, and they interact. And the play, so one of the things, like when I got the play, it's like trying to figure out, okay, how can we best tell this story, and thinking about themes and what's important. I wanted to figure out how best to stage it. So there were a couple of decisions that we had to make along the way, like in terms of the graveyard. Well, first of all, like how it was going to be staged. So we could put it on, we call it proscenium stage, so it looks like mm-hmm. a picture, so you could put them up on the stage. Mm-hmm. But instead, it felt more like in the round thing mm-hmm. would work. So luckily, with the space that we were in, we were able to adapt it so that we could do that. So it was like a thrust in the round stage, which really helps to create interesting pictures. So that's a choice that we had to make, like thinking mm-hmm. about like how should it be staged, and then thinking about costuming, because we wanted the ghosts to somehow be different, but I didn't want it to look too like Halloween-y. You know, mm-hmm. I didn't want it to look like too Beetlejuicy, you know, yeah. or anything like that. So we just had them all in shades of gray, mm-hmm. And then also in period costumes from their time, since they were mm-hmm. Their different time periods. So we had to make choices about costumes and then props and then the staging. With how we wanted it to look, and I know that we had a unique opportunity with this show since it was set at Charles Evans, mm-hmm. and that it was uniquely ground to that mm-hmm. space, that we took the cast actually to Charles Evans, so we had a chance to like walk around and get a sense of the feel of the space, mm-hmm. and that really did change how choices that we make. And the actors, because it was so serene, you know, and the mm-hmm. feeling of Charles Evans was really unique mm-hmm. and one that we really worked to bring into it. And like from a practical standpoint too, Charles Evans, I don't know if you've ever been there, but the, but it's, again, it's beautiful, but there are no straight lines. Like, mm-hmm. even the grave markers, they're all over the place. And that mm-hmm. that informed me with how we were directed it, how mm-hmm. the movement, mm-hmm. that we had no straight lines. So we tried to, like, have that they were constantly in motion and in circles. Mm-hmm. So, like, you have choices like that along the way. And really, it's while working with the actors and asking them, okay, what are you feeling here? Like, what do you think you should be doing? Like, what like moments to emphasize or to pull back on, and pictures that you want to create, figuring out, like, who, what, where do you want the audience to be looking, and then how can you stage people so that they're looking at the right mm-hmm. place, and who's in a position of power and who's not, so you're making choices along the way mm-hmm. for those things. Mm-hmm. I know it was a long, drawn-out response.
But that was a
terrific mm-hmm. experience. So I really loved working with the cast. They were all really terrific, and I was happy with where we were mm-hmm. going. And, you know, like, I never feel like, it's done. You know what
yeah.
I mean? You know what I mean? Because, mm-hmm. like, even... Like, while the show, we were fortunate that we had 2 weekends, so we could run mm-hmm. ran it 8 performances, I think, 7, I'm not sure, but we ran it for a number of performances.
Yeah, 8, I think it was.
And it continues to evolve, you mm-hmm. know, and when watching it, I would, you know, love to continue, like, playing with it, because it's never going to reach, like, I never have a sense that it's done. Like, there's always stuff that we can still mm-hmm. play with and still... Mm-hmm. explore, you know, because mm-hmm. it, again, it's really just about exploring ideas and connections and finding possibilities. Mm-hmm. So,
and that's one of the interesting things about it is after you're done with production, maybe if you get the chance to sit down with everyone and talk about it and mm-hmm. say what worked, what didn't work, what could we have done differently, what might have worked, but in this situation, but not in that situation. Mm-hmm. I remember a number of my theater experiences, especially in college, and all is that we would sit down after the show was over and say, "Okay, we all did a great job. Okay, now what worked and what didn't work on this, and all, and talk turkey on mm-hmm. it." And it was one of places that I learned a lot from, because I said, okay, yeah, this worked, but wow, what would have happened if we did it this way? You know, maybe doing Shakespeare with in the theme of a stained glass picture or mm-hmm. something like that. You know, how would that change a production, as looking at that as, you know, maybe this is what the show is about.
You know, and you know, the interesting is there is no absolute right way to do it. You know,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
so it's all about choices that you make mm-hmm. and how they blend together, and then the mm-hmm. those choices then create mm-hmm. something that's brand new that has never been done in exactly that mm-hmm. that way. You know, so again, it's a process that continues, and it's a process that there's not a frozen moment,
mm-hmm.
You know, and that's the theater, and the fact that when you create it,
mm-hmm.
it's there just for that moment, and then it's mm-hmm. gone, you know, so like it's mm-hmm. that immediacy of it, I think, that mm-hmm. adds to the how exciting theater is, and that when you're like in an audience, like you're experiencing that moment, mm-hmm. that performance with, it's a shared thing that everybody's in, and everybody's breathing the same air, you know, and everybody has that moment. And then even if it's recorded, it's not the same, you mm-hmm. know, it's there's something that's unique and communal about mm-hmm. the theater mm-hmm. experience.
Maybe the home viewer might like to get an idea about how you might go about directing a spot, and you know, pick at random, or maybe if you know, well, a suggestion from me, and give me something to work with, and then maybe a line or two, and then work with me to create this character. This is a lot improv,
okay.
But you know,
sure. Is there something that you have memorized that you that we can work with?
No, I don't have anything memorized. I haven't been on the boards lately for a lot of things. I did do one. Earlier this year with the Reading Theatre Project Fringe Festival. Mm-hmm. And all.
Do you know what I do? I have something that we can share. It's an example, it's like highlighting something. So I had talked earlier about things working from the inside out, mm-hmm. versus from the outside in, mm-hmm. and I can give you a couple of exercises or things to do that highlight that point.
Okay, so, that would be,
so if we want to stand up, all right.
I'll take this coat off, make sure. So,
so the first one is emphasizing the importance of of working from the inside out.
Mm-hmm.
So actually we'll do this together. So the first thing is just raise your hands up in the air. So just raise your hands mm-hmm. up in the air. All right, put them down. That's not that interesting. Now what I want to do is I'm going to ask you to raise your hand up in the air, but then imagine that you are starving.
Okay.
You are so hungry, and the food that you want is on a shelf that is just out of reach. So mm-hmm. it's 8 feet in the air, and you've got to try to reach it. So mm-hmm. now I want you, mm-hmm. with your arms in the air, to try to reach that food. Mm-hmm. Ready, and go. So you're going, you're trying to get it, but you can't quite get it. All right. So now we're going to add something else to it. So that now picture that you are so hungry that you have stomach cramps. Mm-hmm. And then when you're trying to reach, every time you reach, it hurts inside. Uh-huh. All right, so we're going to try to reach this time, but now you have stomach cramps.
Mm-hmm.
So ready, and go. So you go, but I'm going to try to.
Yeah.
All right, got it. So now if we sit down, then we can talk about that a second. So the first time that I had you just raise your arms mm-hmm. up in the air, that's not connected to anything.
No.
So if you think about it, when we raise your arms up in the air, that's just, mm-hmm. I don't know if you've had the experience of if you've been in an English classroom, high school English classroom, and you're reading a text,
mm-hmm.
and it's just the person reading it just isn't connected to anything, mm-hmm. to be or not to be. That is the quote, mm-hmm. They're just reading through it and they're not into it. So when you raise your arms mm-hmm. up in the air, it's not connected to anything.
Mm-hmm.
But if I give you a situation and I give you an objective, mm-hmm. when you were trying to reach for something, mm-hmm. that was a lot more interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So when watching and reaching for that food that's right up in the air, because we clarified the situation that you were starving, you have that food there, mm-hmm. your objective mm-hmm. is to try to get that food.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting, it's more interesting to watch you try to get that mm-hmm. food than you just putting your arms up mm-hmm. in the air. Then if I add an obstacle where mm-hmm. you have stomach cramps, so I'm trying to reach mm-hmm. but I can't because my stomach hurts.
Mm-hmm.
That's another layer of something mm-hmm. that you add into it that makes it even more interesting and more layered. So that's the idea, and I think meant to emphasize objectives, mm-hmm. tactics. Your tactic is mm-hmm. how you're going about doing it, and then obstacles. Mm-hmm. Those things are kind of some of the core things in the actor's toolbox.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that would be that.
Yeah. And then... the director wants the actor to learn the lines. Now, they may have some things, having some trouble or something like that with it, they may be trying to connect this movement with their lines, but they have to kind of multitask and all. One of the acting coaches I had years ago suggested that while I might be doing dishes at home, have the lines right up there, close pinned to the curtains or whatever in front of me while I'm doing this, and trying to do the lines by doing something else.
Yeah.
While doing, and that was a good way to show me and other people you have to be engaged in everything, whether it's you're trying to talk to someone, or maybe, and nowadays on the phone, you've got these earbuds or whatever, and doing that.
Yeah, like as far as lines go, like there are so many different, like I've talked to lots of people about, like how do you memorize lines? So think about that. And like some people will like look at the script over and over again. Somebody will work with somebody. Yeah. And that they'll like quiz each other online. Some people will listen to it over and over. What I have found, and the thing that I tell people, is you want to try to engage as many senses as possible. So when you're trying to recall it, what does it look like on the page? What does it sound like? There are a bunch. There are many like the line learning apps. Like one's Line Learner. Another one's I think called Rehearse. That you can record your lines and then listen to them. But what you can do is like record your line and also your cue line, and then it'll remove the cue line so that you're just getting your cue line into it. So there are lots of like tricks that you can do. But I found, again, engage as many of the senses as you can. Like your example of like doing while you're doing the dishes. So that you can connect it with your movements. Like knowing what your blocking is can also be a trigger for remembering your lines. But engage as many of your senses as possible and repetition. So it's just doing it again and again and again. So it seems like it's happening for the first time in front of the stage, but it's the 400th time that you've gone through. You know, that's as a director, that's one thing. We'll do it one more time, which is a lie, because then we're going to do it like 10 more times.
Yeah.
So it's just doing it again and again and again and through repetition. You know, and especially like Shakespeare. So when I've directed a number of Shakespeare productions, and Shakespeare productions with kids, and then afterwards, like parents will say, oh my gosh, how did they learn all those lines? Then that's the number one question, like the response that you get is, how did you learn all those lines? And to be honest, like I don't focus on that. Like I don't think of, like the lines, we try to have those done well in advance. Like there's a date where they have to be off book, and then there's a date where they're not going to get cues anymore, so that it's solid. And that's a step in the process. That's not the final goal, isn't for them just to say the words that were scripted, or to stand in the right spot, or to gesture to the right way. It's about connecting, and it's about making something that is authentic, and that that's crafted, So the lines, are a step along the way, and it's an important step, But I'm not thinking about lines when we're down to the final dress rehearsals. They're done. So,
Once you're there, you have to trust the actor, trust the situation that you're in, because you never know what's going to happen. I mean, there's been crazy things happening off stage.
Oh, right.
During a performance or even just prior to a performance.
You've had fire alarms go off.
Exactly, yeah. We had, I remember once in college that happened. Around here, one of my earlier experiences at Genesius, we were doing the Sound of Music, and just about a half hour before we were to open the curtain, the one line broke on the drop.
Oh my gosh.
So it had to be repaired and re strung. And what are we going to do? And I was doing a couple of different things with the production, and they asked me about that. I go, let's go. I got this. Got a ladder, got situated so that I could retie the rope and all, but it's just crazy. And in this case, the curtains didn't open. It was stage was open right from the beginning.
Right, right.
And all. So here I am. They get a second show. But you know, you never can tell.
No.
And all. You were talking. You know, when we did that exercise with that reaching for bread or food, we started with both hands up. The nice thing about that was it also opened up the body.
Oh, right.
You know, you have warm-ups for these rehearsals.
Yeah, it sounds odd, but even like non-musicals, mm-hmm. We do warm-ups beforehand to get, I don't know, loosened up so mm-hmm. that your movement is more free, but also it connects the actors. Like mm-hmm. we have games so that it relies on them building timing with each mm-hmm. other. I don't know, and just being goofy and free. You know, yeah. like there's something to be said about that. So we mm-hmm. do warm ups. It's a way to connect, a way to stretch, way to make your movement mm-hmm. More open. So. Yeah.
It's like a vocalist, it's like a dancer, an athlete, anyone. You know, you have to have whatever you're going to use available to use it in any and all ways.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and it's about sharing energy. Like, mm-hmm. and those games too are a way kind of to separate what was happening in your life before, mm-hmm. like before you walked in the mm-hmm. doors of rehearsal, then you're here, then we're doing games. It's like, okay, now it's time to rehearse, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's a nice way to, you know, that you can escape whatever craziness has gone on in your life, that mm-hmm. your focus is here now. So it's a good kind of marker that, okay, mm-hmm. rehearsal has begun, you know, mm-hmm. and then we move from there. So I usually try to start with mm-hmm. warm-ups in some way. Mm-hmm.
It's a way of also building concentration and all being able to give and take. I know there are a number of different exercises where you go boop boop and all, and everyone has to be alert and aware to keep that going.
Right. You know, because the rhythm of the show too is a real thing. So mm-hmm. like the script, like when you, it's kind of like riding a wave, you know, like mm-hmm. so once the show kind of is developed and you're kind of in the rehearsal process, the script follows. It's almost musical, like even mm-hmm. non-musicals, but there it's like musical, and you've got to keep up with the beat of it. Mm-hmm. You know, and in those warm-up games, like we do games that require people like to listen and focus and mm-hmm. concentrate, and if you don't do that during the warm-up games, everything kind of stops or it mm-hmm. falls apart. Well, the same thing in mm-hmm. rehearsal, you know, so mm-hmm. like as a rehearsal's going on, it's important that like everybody's like that, just like a band, like mm-hmm. or just like an orchestra, that everybody is adding to the rhythm, and even like the like sounds of like walking or like mm-hmm. Like other sounds. It's all part of the wave of mm-hmm. the script that you're mm-hmm. that you're creating. It's like riding the wave and mm-hmm. following that along.
So do you have any projects planned at this point in time?
Reading Theater project. So I'm helping out with their Fringe Festival coming up.
Okay.
So I'm helping to organize that. Mm-hmm. That comes up in February. Mm-hmm. And I was involved with that last year for the first time. It's mm-hmm. really a neat thing. Mm-hmm. Local playwrights mm-hmm. have a chance for their work to be shown and then staged by local actors and directors and mm-hmm. and you know, tech folks, and so I'm working on that. We're still in the early stages mm-hmm. of that mm-hmm. That they're starting to collect scripts now. But yeah, that'll be up. So Reading Theater Projects, spring one act festival. So mm-hmm. I'm going to be helping out with that. I might mm-hmm. be directing, I'm not sure, but mm-hmm. but definitely mm-hmm. helping out.
What are the challenges with as a director with doing these short pieces, and on maybe how the playwright or anyone else might react to these short pieces.
You know what, that's been terrific. So I've, over the last year or so I've done a couple of them mm-hmm. where I've had a chance to talk with the playwright. And mm-hmm. you know, if you're doing a big musical, that doesn't happen. So you don't
right.
get a chance to meet mm-hmm. Stephen Schwartz normally. You know,
right.
But to work with the playwrights, it was really interesting to get their perspective. Mm-hmm. Now, I've worked with two or three, mm-hmm. and they've been really generous and open to ideas. But it's interesting to see where, like, the genesis of the stories came from, like what the heart of it, what their intent was. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting to have those conversations, and that's a whole new dimension that I haven't had a lot of experience with mm-hmm. before, and that's been terrific. Like getting mm-hmm. a chance to work with the playwrights.
Mm. That's one of the nice things about Reading Theater Project and a couple other theater companies in the area is that they're nourishing and encouraging new playwrights.
Yeah, and some really terrific things, like mm-hmm. really great. Ideas and some great work that's being done. Some of the plays have been really mm-hmm. top-notch. So,
yeah. And I think that may be part of where the director can come in and help developing playwright to create their piece and all.
Watching some mm-hmm. of the plays that others were working on in mm-hmm. the Fringe Festival and also mm-hmm. in the past, present, future, mm-hmm. Listening to the playwrights talk about how the play was taken in a direction that they hadn't expected, mm-hmm. which, I mean, they embraced that, you know, mm-hmm. and they said that was mm-hmm. really an interesting thing. So, mm-hmm. You know, the creative, collaborative process is mm-hmm. one that, you know, is alive and well with that, and it's neat to include the playwrights in that whole mm-hmm. that whole journey. So,
yeah, it's a great learning experience for everyone because you have the playwright maybe getting some ideas about what can and cannot be done mm-hmm. In a given situation what the director can and cannot do with the what he or she's given.
Yeah, and you know, you're not going to get the same perspective reading it on a page. Like, it'll bring so much new to it mm-hmm. once you get other artists involved and bring it up. So, mm-hmm. but just like the timing of it or things that worked in like the playwright's mm-hmm. head that once it gets on, you realize that it's clunky, you know, or like the yeah. wording doesn't quite work. So that's interesting mm-hmm. to see the playwrights go through that mm-hmm. journey, like in rewriting on the fly mm-hmm. to clean things up is mm-hmm. really fascinating. So that's an interesting thing.
Yeah. Well, it's been wonderful having you on the program to talk about this. I hope you at home have gotten a little bit more idea about what goes into a theater production that you see, and you get a chance to understand it a little bit more, and maybe even get interested in participating in a production from the backstage or on stage side of it, no matter what. But there are a lot of good things coming up. Albright is doing their improv festival in February, and the Steel River Playhouse is doing things. So check in with us and check the websites for the different theaters in this area. Jody, thanks very much.
A pleasure.
May you and your family have a wonderful holiday, and you take good care.
Thanks, you too.
Thank you. And you at home, thanks for being with us. May you have a wonderful and blessed holiday, no matter how you celebrate it. Take good care, and we'll see you next year. Good night.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.